She works at the Department of Educational Science, Education Research, Education and Community Intervention, Citizenship, Education and Political Psychology, how many things? Research Product Projects Coordinator, Expert in Groups in Risk of Exclusion in a Broad Sense. Very good.
Thank you.
On your.
Could you please make a note to my rector? Yeah. I'm sorry. Okay, good morning, everyone. Obviously, after Zara's talk, it's very difficult. So you've put the band really high, so it's very difficult. But I'm a teacher. This means that the micro is always a problem because I speak very loud. Anyway, so let me put this further away so that you won't be deaf in the process. So first, thank you, Karma, for the invitation. And I have a huge responsibility here because I'm going to speak about the project and the outputs of the project and the contributions of the project. And all my colleagues are here. So they all were involved in this. They will throw me things at me during the presentation. And for once, it was really very nice for me. And I have to thank all of the people in the project, because it was really very good to be able to reach all the materials again and in a more distanced way in order to try to make sense of it. If I manage to make sense or not, you will tell me at the end. But it was really great fun and it was very interesting. So let's start with the beginning. What did we aim to in the beginning? And basically we had these four major work packages or main research where we started with existing research and existing practice. So the idea was to pick up on research on the issue of migrant and minority students in higher education and trying to understand what research was telling us about this, and also try to identify in the partner universities and in other universities in the participating countries a series of practices that would be interesting in terms of the inclusion of migrant and minority students. I keep using migrant and minority. It's very nice because it's M&M. So it's migrant and minority students in the university. The second thing was to start with a survey of students' perspectives, students' experiences, and then to try to, based on that, develop a set of guidelines that would help us create interventions. And in fact, there are 21 different curricula that Camila, I think, is going also to approach, or other colleagues are going to approach in the sessions today and tomorrow, in the workshops today and tomorrow. But in fact, we did things in our universities. We planned, we discussed with professors, we experimented ways of doing this in our universities. We monitored the results of the process, and this was done in the universities, and based on this, a set of guidelines for creating learning environments that are inclusive, that are integrating students in higher education were set up. Then also in the continuation of the process, there was a course design that was made by the team in Finland, that was led by the team in Finland. The previous one was led by Maynooth, sorry. And the idea was to create a course that could be replicated in the participating countries and that was directed to higher education staff and teachers in order to open up, develop their competencies in dealing with diversity in the universities. And finally, a work that was led by the university, the Catholic University of Louvain, it was a set of recommendations for policy that were derived. So I'm going to refer all this in a little bit more detail, and then I will try to make some sense of the whole project. So this is the way in which we organize the existing literature. And as I was listening to Zara, I was identifying many of the things the literature tells us about the structural conditions, for instance, the social demographic or the previous educational experiences, the quality of social or secondary education, and the way in which teachers in secondary education, in a way, generate and support expectations to advance to higher education are absolutely essential structural conditions that could either facilitate or hinder transition to higher education. The literature also refers to educational policies, how educational policies can facilitate or, in fact, become major obstacles to entrance in higher education. And of course, it is also important when we think about entrance in higher education, access and success, to consider the role of educational policies. Finally, the cultural and political dynamics, globalization issues, multiculturalism, all the discourse that now is we are witnessing in terms of what is political correctedness, which is a terrible discussion to, and probably another name for racism and discrimination, now reframed in this way that we are against political correctedness. But this is obviously a very huge discussion that we are having now, and that also shows how this project makes, I'm not saying it makes more sense now than at the beginning, but it surely makes a lot of sense now as it did in the beginning. So this idea of the cultural and political dynamics that are very important in a country, and that takes Zara to be, after 20 years, the first student to study education. It's something that you say, yeah, great, but at some time you want to cry. Yeah. So it's a terrible thing. The other thing has to do with the experience in higher education. You have research that calls our attention to institutional practices that could support, for instance, if you have an international office, if you have a university that from the beginning in its mission, in its statements, says that valuing diversity or being against racism is the motto of the university. This is very important. Universities have a huge symbolic power and they should use it. But obviously, this also takes a very clear idea of what they are saying. And then you have the student experience in itself. I think that Zara made it obvious, in class, out of class, the opportunities you have to interact with teachers, the curricula. Well, the role of Jesus in the curricula is something new to our reflection, but obviously it's important. The other thing is obviously the out-of-class experiences, the interaction with peers, with whom you obviously learn. You learn a lot when you are in the university because you go to a cafe and you discuss, you take coffee and coffee after coffee and you discuss what you learn in classes. And if you discuss with someone that is not looking you in the eyes, then it's a whole different experience. And obviously this is a very important thing. And finally, curricular experiences, international study options, and the way in which these study options can be tricky. Let me give you an example. If I have a class where all the students, where I teach in English exclusively, this means that many of the national students, the local students, will probably not attend this class. So I'm creating yet another experience of exclusion inside the university. And this is very interesting and very important. And finally, research also discusses outcomes for individuals, institutions, and societies as a whole, and the advantages and disadvantages that this can generate. In terms of the practices, we also reviewed a lot that is happening there. First, research. It's important that we do research on migrant and minority students and their experiences, because obviously this might be important for teachers, for the students themselves, for other people, because in fact we are dealing with a lot of ignorance on our part in relation to this new, relatively new, unfortunately, but relatively new experiences. And therefore, to do research, to share the results is very important. Then you have the dissemination of useful information about job opportunities. A lot is being done on language and intercultural training. And even yesterday, you were saying that language is a main issue. It continues to be a main issue. And again, your experience also reflects this. A lot of intervention projects that are of either more related to study skills or more related to other stuff, and then policies. Scholarships, waivers, reduction of fees, combination of methods, recognition of prior learning. You have a variety of things going on there. So we're coming now to what a project is. And I'm talking here about some of the data that was collected. It was a small-scale studies that we did in the universities with group of students who shared what they saw. And what I try to do is try to bring you some of this information. And that seems to be a tendency in some cases that of a misrepresentation of a non-existent of the experience of migrant and minority students, either because they are not represented at all in the curricula, in classes, they are completely ignored, or because they are represented as someone who is the other, or that comes from the wrong part of the world. And this is very vivid and appears in the statements of many of the students across the various participating countries. So the idea of a single story, as Chimamanda Adichie, whom some of you might know, a writer from Nigeria, says, a single story, you look at that person as the person with problems, and then you have a sense of humor. Wow, as if this was a discovery, because the other obviously is very different from myself. And this is a major thing. The second thing is the strategies that the students use. In some cases, when they can, undercover identities, you try to look like you are one of them. But of course, you are not. So you are aware that you are using an undercover identity, but still this is one strategy. And the idea of this student here that says, I felt I belonged when there was no need for me to keep talking about how exotic I am, keep talking about my special characteristics. That's when I felt I belonged. And this obviously is very important. They also have a series of strategies that resonate with some of the things that Zara says. For instance, this idea that compulsory group work that mandates working with at least one minority member tells you the difficulties that these students experience in their daily life, in their interaction with colleagues, which obviously makes us feel that there are huge problems out there that we should address. And obviously this code that I use as a subtitle, it is not a matter of a university program, it is a matter of the heart. It is a matter of a cultural attitude towards those who are different. And whether you decide to welcome them in a genuine way or not, and this is of course very important. In terms of this, so using this information, the research review, then you have the proposal of guidelines for creating intercultural learning environments. And one of the outputs, which is out there, by the way, is this idea that you have to work on yourself as a teacher, your own identity, your own cultural assumptions, reflect on the teaching methods and the research methods that you use. And I would like here also to stress this recommendation to try to go beyond the global north and try to look if you're not being biased. We are all being biased towards the global north, we know, but to try to explicitly contradict this in terms of your practice by including references, examples that go beyond that. And at the institutional level, the adoption of policies that value integration and that confront racism and discrimination. And this has to be a clear-cut policy in the universities. And I do feel that this is one of the major outputs, exactly because it stresses very clearly what is to be done. The other very significant output is the work done by our colleagues in Turku University, where you have principles underpinning the development of a continuing professional development course. And what, again, they are emphasizing is the need that you have to have always taking a deep analysis on yourself as a teacher, yourself as a member of the staff, your identity as an important point of departure, and then the need to make a shift of cultural frames of references in order to guarantee, and this I think is really an important message, that the learning process for all the students, not only the migrant of minority, is a rich process. Because if you guarantee this, you guarantee a higher quality experience, not only for migrant and minority students, but for all the students. And obviously pinpointing also problems of omission, underrepresentation, distortion of discriminated groups, including from an historical perspective. And again, the need to tell the multiple stories that go behind the story, the European bias that we all have, together with recommending active and collaborative learning, reflective practice, dialogical learning, inclusiveness as important strategies. Finally, the policy recommendations. So there is quite a lot that was done by the team at UCL, namely in terms of the promotion of cultural diversity into higher education. And here I would really like to stress the first recommendation: celebrate human diversity. Come on, we are, and I rest here, one of my most loved philosophers is Hannah Arendt. And one of the things she says is that as human beings, we are inevitably different. And therefore, diversity is a basic condition of existence, a condition of the self. So politics, she also says, is exactly what happens when two people come together, because they must negotiate their differences from the beginning. So the fact that we don't only recognize that there are different things, but recognize that there is an inevitability of these differences. And this is something which is great, not something that you should get depressed and say, oh, I like to work with people that are similar to me. Similar to you? Come on, it would be a nightmare, yeah, of a terrible thing. So 1984 to I don't know, other dystopic novels that tell you how bad this experience would be. So this idea of diversity, of sharing, of valuing diversity is really very important. The second thing is obviously that you have to bring diversity into the curricula. You have to create opportunities not only to open access, but also to promote and support success. It's not only to say the door is open, come in, but it's also to create the conditions that would make the person feel comfortable and have the opportunity to go through the process as similar to the experience of others as possible, which implies that you have to have diversity skills from the point of view of both teachers, but also staff in the university that will be able to deal with this diversity in another way, and obviously use collaboration to solve intercultural questions. In terms of creating the conditions for sustainability, for integration of cultural diversity in higher education, the idea that you have to create sustainable policies. So you have to have the financial resources that are granted to the support of these policies. And this is a major thing. So it cannot result if you are using something today and then in 6 months you change the policy and then 6 months you do something else. So the idea that you need some kind of joint effort, and we are dealing with a major issue. So please take this into account. So what I've done so far is to present you the work of my colleagues. So it's the work that we've done that was led by universities with the collaboration of the partners. And now it's the time for a little bit of diversity. I was reading Enrique Dussel, which is a philosopher from Latin America, from Argentina. I said, I'm going to put this. I'm not going to translate this. I'm going to put this. We are discussing the issues of translation with Camila and Kia yesterday. And I'm not translating. But the nice thing about this, his experience, this is a text he wrote in 2005. And I studied in Argentina and I studied philosophy. And he was studying all the great European philosophers. So we said, back in the 50s in Argentina, we thought of ourselves as Europeans. Mm-hmm. It was obvious for us that we were Europeans. And it is only in 1957, when I came by boat to Europe, and I landed in Lisboa and in Barcelona, mm-hmm. that I understand that I was shocked, because I was not an European, I was a Latin American, and he had no clue whatsoever what the hell did it mean to be a Latin American. So we discovered his identity as a Latin American in Europe when he was recognized and he saw himself as the other. So he spent all of his career trying to make sense of this. He said this became an obsession to me in my work, from all the points of view, epistemological, ontological, because in fact, what does it mean? What does it mean, and what also does it mean for history, for philosophy, to be a Latin American? And his reflection, I think, also bring us to the points I was wanting to make in the reading. I'm coming to the end, in the reading of the project, which is the idea that it just takes a street. You just have to change from one street to the other to become the other. So it doesn't take much. It doesn't take much. And we should keep this in mind, because to be experienced as the other is a basic human experience that we can all have. So, ways forward. I'm using here a concept of the pluriversity to instead of a university, because of this idea that we should start within universities to cherish epistemic diversity, to understand that knowledge from various sources is important, should be there. We should in the least recognize it and create conditions for a dialogue with this. And in a place where we are all exotic, mm-hmm. we should all be recognized as exotic. And this is an important point of departure. For me, this means several things that come from this project. That recognizing that we are still talking of a situation where this particular group of students experiences strong disadvantages. And it takes courage, but it takes a lot of courage. And maybe it's time for us to start arguing that it takes courage, but it could take a little bit less than actually it does now. No one should be put in a position where so much courage is necessary. Yeah, we should be courageous, but we must also breathe, have space to breathe. The second thing is that we need to recognize as researchers, as academics, that there are huge problems of racism and discrimination in Europe. And we must define which side are we on. And we should be on the side that claims that this is unacceptable for universities, and therefore to start acting as one. And clearly we need a dialogical perspective, but please take into account two things. This is a huge imbalance of power between the groups that are sitting at the table here. And some of these groups are not even sitting at the table. They don't have a table even, or they don't have a bench. And therefore, the idea that we are also, and George was making this point yesterday about the idea to the need to recognize the diversity within diversity, the fact that we are talking about migrant and minorities, we are talking also of huge conditions of inequality, of difference, layers of difference that are here, and obviously there are significant asymmetries of power that generate also significant discrimination. So for me, what I have to say to my colleagues is thank you, and thank you for the good work that you've done. I hope I haven't betrayed you that much. Thank you.